Harper Teen and Harper Audio present Blade Breaker by Victoria Aveyard, performed by Natalie Naudus. To those who bend but never break. 1. No choice but death. Corayne. The voice echoed as if down a long passage, distant and fading, difficult to make out. But it shuddered within her, a sound as much as a feeling. She felt it in her spine, her ribs, every bone. Her own heartbeat pounded in time with the terrible voice. It spoke no words she knew, but still, Corayne understood its anger. His anger. Dimly, Corayne wondered if this was death or simply another dream. The roar of what waits called to her through the darkness, clinging, even as warm hands pulled her back to the light. Corayne sat up, blinking, gasping for breath, the world rushing back around her. She found herself sitting in water up to her chest. It rippled, a dirty mirror reflecting the oasis town. The Nesri oasis had been beautiful once, filled with green palms and cool shade. The sand dunes were a golden band around the horizon. The kingdom of Abal stretched in every direction, with the red cliffs of the Marjeja to the south, the waves of the Alger and the Long Sea to the north. Nesri was a pilgrim town, built around sacred waters and a temple to Lazrin, its buildings white and green tiled, its streets wide enough for the desert caravans. Now those wide streets were choked with corpses, coiled serpent bodies, and broken soldiers. Corayne fought back a wave of revulsion, but continued to look, her eyes passing through the debris. She searched for the spindle, a golden thread spitting a torrent of water and monsters. But nothing stood in its place, not even an echo. No memory of what existed a moment before. Only the broken columns and shattered causeway remained in testament to the Kraken. And, Corayne realized, the bloody ruin of a tentacle, cut neatly from the monster as it was forced back into its own realm. It lay among the puddles like a fallen old tree. She swallowed hard and nearly gagged. The water tasted of rot and death and the spindle, gone but for a fading echo, like a ringing in her ears. She tasted blood, too. The blood of Galish soldiers, the blood of sea serpents from another realm, and, of course, her own. So much blood, Corayne felt she might drown in it. But I am a pirate's daughter, she thought, heart pounding. Her mother, the bronzed and beautiful Melis and Amarat, grinned in her mind's eye. We do not drown. Corayne, a voice said, shockingly gentle. She looked up to find Andri standing over her. The blood was on him too, smeared across his tunic and the familiar blue star. A jolt of panic shot through Corayne as she searched his face, his limbs, looking for some terrible wound. She remembered Andri fighting hard, a knight as much as any of the soldiers he slew. After a moment, she knew the blood was not his own. Sighing, she felt some tightness lift from her shoulders. Corayne, Andri said again, his hand working into hers. Without thought, she tightened her grip on his fingers and forced herself to stand on shaking legs. His eyes shone with concern. I'm fine, Corayne bit out, feeling the opposite. Even as she caught her balance, her mind spun, the last few moments washing over her. The spindle, the serpents, the kraken, Valtic's spell, Dom's rage, my own blood on the edge of the sword. She sucked down another gasp of air, trying to center herself. Andri kept his hand on her shoulder, ready to catch her should she fall. Corayne would not. She straightened her spine. Her gaze flew to the spindle blade, submerged in half a foot of corrupted water, gleaming with shadow and sunlight. The current moved over the sword until the steel itself seemed to dance. The old language of a realm long lost ran the length of the sword, etched into the metal. Corayne couldn't read the letters nor pronounce the words. As always, their meaning lay just beyond her grasp. Then her hand plunged into the water, closing on the hilt of the spindle blade. The sword splashed free, cold and dripping. Her heart faltered. There was no blood on the sword, not anymore, but she could still see it. The kraken, the serpents, and the Galish soldiers dead by her own hand. Mortal lives ended, cut in half like the spindle. She tried not to think of the men she'd killed. Their faces came anyway, haunting in her memory. "How many?" she said, her voice trailing off. Corayne didn't expect Andre to understand the broken musings of her mind. But pain crossed his face, a pain she knew. He looked beyond her to the bodies in green and gold. He shut his eyes and bowed his head, hiding his face from the desert sun. "I don't know," he replied. "I will not count." "I have never seen a heart break before," Corayne thought, watching Andre Treland. He wore no wounds, but she knew he bled within. Once he was a squire of Galland who dreamed of becoming a knight. And now he is a killer of them. A killer of his own dreams. For once, words failed Corayne and Amrat, and she turned away to stand alone. Her eyes roved over their surroundings, taking in the destruction fanning out from the center of the town. The oasis felt eerily quiet after the battle. Corayne almost expected some echo to remain, the cry of a kraken or a serpent's hiss. She could hear the old witch Valtic as she wandered through the limestone ruins, humming to herself, skipping like a child. Corayne watched her bend a few times, collecting fangs from the serpent corpses. There were already a few teeth braided into her long gray hair. She was her strange, bewildering self again, just an old woman puttering around. But Corayne knew better. Only moments ago, the Yiddy woman and her rhymes had driven the kraken back, clearing a path for Corayne and the Spindleblade. There was deep power in the witch. But if Valtic cared or even remembered, she did not show it. Either way, Corayne was glad to have her. The abolit sun continued to rise, hot against Corayne's back, and then suddenly cool as a long shadow fell over her. She looked up, her face falling. Demacreon, immortal prince of Iona, was red from eyebrows to toes, painted in swaths of blood. His once fine tunic and cloak were ruined, torn and stained. His pale skin looked rusted, his golden hair gone to fire. Only his eyes remained clear, white and emerald green, burning like the sun above him. His great sword all but dangled from his fist, threatening to fall. He heaved a rattling breath.
"Are you well, Corayne?"
Dom said, his voice grinding and strangled. Corayne balked.
"Are you?"
A muscle flexed in his jaw.
"I must make myself clean,"
he murmured, bending to the water. Red clouds bloomed from his skin. "It will take more than that," Corayne wanted to say. "For all of us."
"All of us."
Corayne jolted, a sudden shock of panic arcing through her. Her eyes darted, searching the town for the rest of the companions, heart in her teeth. Charlie, Sigil, Sarasa. She did not hear or see them, and fear churned in her gut.
"So many lost today. Gods, don't let us lose them too."
As much as her own sins weighed in her mind, their lives weighed more. Before Corayne could call out, yell their names across the oasis, a man groaned. She snapped to the sound, Andre and Dom flanking her like guards. Corayne exhaled when she saw the Galish soldier. He was wounded, crawling through the water, now steadily draining into the sand. His green cloak weighed him down, slowing his progress as he slithered forward, pawing through the mud. Blood bubbled from his lips, his only words a gurgle. Lazarine comes for him, Corayne thought, naming the death goddess. And she is not the only one. Sarasasarn abandoned her shadows, stepping into the light with the grace of a dancer and the focus of a falcon. She was not as bloody as Dom, but her tattooed hands and bronze dagger dripped scarlet, her eyes fixed on the soldier's back, never wavering as she followed him.
"Still alive, Sigil?"
she said, calling out to the bounty hunter. Her manner was easy, even as she stalked a dying man across the town center. A hearty laugh and a scuffle of feet answered from a nearby rooftop. Sigil's broad frame appeared, wrestling with a Gallish soldier in broken armor. He raised a knife, but Sigil caught his wrist with a grin.
"The iron bones of the Countless will never be broken," she laughed, snapping his hold.
The knife fell, and she hoisted him over her shoulder. He wailed in opposition, fists beating against her leather armor.
"You cannot say the same."
It was not far to fall, only 2 stories, but the water was shallow. He broke his neck with a wet crack. Corayne did not flinch. She had seen far worse today. Slowly, she blew out a breath, steadying herself. As if summoned, Charlie stepped out into the street. His eyes fell on the body, his face devoid of emotion.
"Into the hands of mighty Cyrek go you, son of Gallant, son of war,"
the fallen priest said, bending over the body. He brushed his ink-stained fingers through the water, touching the soldier's unseeing eyes. Corayne realized Charlie was giving him as close to a godly burial as he could offer. When Charlie stood again, his face was blank and pale, his long hair free from its usual braid.
"Alive. All of them. All of us."
Relief surged through Corayne's body, swiftly followed by exhaustion. She flagged a little, her knees going weak. Andrew moved quickly, bracing his hands against her shoulders.
"It's all right," he said softly.
His touch was almost electrifying, hot and cold all at once. She jumped away and shook her head.
"I will not mourn them," she muttered sharply. "I will not mourn men who would have killed us. You shouldn't mourn them either."
Andrew's face tightened, his lips threatening a scowl. Corayne had never seen anger on Andrew Treland, not like this. Even the shadow of it stung.
"I cannot do that, Corayne,"
he bit out, turning away. Corayne followed his gaze, a flush of shame crossing her cheeks. Andrew looked back to Charlie, now making his way through the dead, blessing the Gallish corpses. Then his eyes went to the soldier crawling through the muck. The Amhara stalked him still.
"Gods damn you, show some mercy, Sarasa,"
the squire barked.
"Give him an ending!"
The assassin did not break her gaze. She was trained too well to take her eyes off an enemy, even one so wounded.
"You may do as you like, Treland. I won't stop you."
Andrew's throat bobbed, his brown skin bare above the collar of his tunic. His fingers grazed the sword at his side.
"Don't,"
Corayne said, grabbing his bicep. The flesh felt hard beneath her fingers, tight as wound rope.
"Don't give this man mercy, if it means losing another piece of yourself."
Andrew did not answer, but his brow furrowed and his face grew grim. Gently, he shrugged Corayne away and drew his sword.
"Andrew," she began, moving to stop him.
Then a ripple went through the water and something splashed, its skin coiling and scaly. Corayne froze, heart pounding. The serpent was alone, but still deadly. Sarasa stopped in her prowl, drawing up short. She watched with her glowing tiger eyes as it unhinged its jaw and took the soldier's head in its mouth. Corayne could not help but be darkly fascinated, her lips parting as the serpent ended the soldier. It was Dom who finished them both, his great sword cutting through scale and skin. He leveled a glare at Sarasa, but she only shrugged, waving him off with a swipe of one red hand. Corayne turned away, shaking her head at the two of them. Andrew was already gone, his footsteps squelching through the wet sand. While Sarasa and Sigil searched the oasis for survivors, the rest of them waited on the outskirts of the town, where Stone Road gave over to sand. Corayne sat in a wind-blown rock, thanking the gods for the blissful shade of a few palm trees. Somehow, she was grateful for the heat, too. It felt cleansing. The others were silent, the only sound the two horses pawing the ground. Andrew kept the sand mares brushing them down.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.